population, the average per capita meat consumption in China has quadrupled. And that figure is taken from 1961, where people ate about 4 kilograms a year of meat, to 2010, where people ate 61 kilograms of meat per year. So that's quadrupling, that's quite a change. I always want to keep in mind that this compared to the United States people eat 120 kilograms of meat per person per year. So it's massive growth, but relatively speaking, it's still half of what we see in places like the United States and Austria and other parts of Western Europe. But in China, when we're talking about meat, of course, there's chicken, there's beef, there's mutton, there's all kinds and forms of meat. But really, the star of this meat boom is pork. In terms of culture, in terms of history, in terms of political economy, it's really about pork in China. And these figures here show some of the scale of pork production. These are from 2014. You see that half of the world's production and consumption of pork are in China, and more than half of the world's pigs actually live in China. In terms of production, China's annual pork production is twice the amount of all EU countries combined, and it's five times the amount in the United States. This is a massive amount of pork produced. And these figures are really the result of about four decades of concerted government efforts to bring these figures up, to bring production and consumption up. Pork production in China is so significant that it shifts global statistics in terms of meat production and different categories of meat. An earlier version of this chart is how I actually got interested in studying the pork industry in China. And I wanted to understand what happened here in 1979 as pork passes beef and later comes to double it. I thought, what? There's a story here. Something really important happened here. And it didn't take long to find out that the story of pork's rise was also the story of China's rise. So in 1978, the year before we see pork's initial uptick, this is the year of reform and opening, when Deng Xiaoping initiated reforms that opened Chinese economy to the world. So during this period, there was a decollectivization of agriculture, private enterprise began to emerge, selective liberalization of different sectors, and at the same time, China starts preparing to enter the WTO. There are massive changes in terms of the structure of the economy and also of social relationships. And so this period of reform and opening, it's a crucial part of understanding how and why it is that pork rose. We have these massive changes that we can say, okay, this makes sense that we see this increase. At the same time, there's processes of more general global integration happening in China. Agribusiness is developing, which I'll talk about. And the state continues to search for ways to maintain legitimacy. So I've argued elsewhere that kind of this focus on meat and focus on increasing pork in particular is a way for the state to claim, we're taking care of you. Things are okay. Things are improving. So it's also wrapped up in state legitimacy. At the same time, to explain this rise, we also need to take into account historical and cultural contexts, and this explains why particularly pork is the meat that's rising. For one thing, pigs have been raised in China for 7,000 years. The southern part of the country is where pigs, one of the sites of domestication of pigs originally. Pigs have a long association with the home, and this I won't go into, but there's stories from the evolution of the characters for pig and home that they share very common origins. And in China today, if you just say you want meat, that means pork. So it's central. At the same time, there's also a social context where meat comes to signify wealth and progress. So these are all kind of contextual issues, I would say, in explaining pork's rise. But beyond these kind of triggering factors, we might say, I'm curious to understand why exactly pork consumption and production is rising. And more generally, why is it that meat production and consumption rises in particular times, in particular places? Which is a question that we don't actually spend much time thinking about. We, in fact, have very little discussion about why meat production and consumption rises. What we do have, especially through a development lens, are a number of unexamined assumptions that meat is progress. The more a society, the more meat a society produces, the more it's developed, the more it's progressing. But meat is an important part of economic growth, especially in terms of agricultural development. But meat is a development goal, also a metric. You can measure development by how much meat people are eating. That meat is simply consumer demand, and that meat is a natural desire. Now, I'm not trying to contest the naturalness of wanting to eat meat. That's not the point. But I do think it's one of these unexamined assumptions that we assume everybody wants to eat meat. So, of course, if there's the opportunity to eat meat, everyone will just eat meat until they're stuffed full. And we have, I would say, kind of two leading ways of thinking about meat rising, again, through a development lens. One is the nutrition transition, coming with the idea of a livestock revolution. So just to quickly explain these key points. The nutrition transition is sort of a theory or a description that says in a particular place, where income rises and where urbanization increases, that diets start to change in predictable ways. Part of that change is that people eat more animal-based fats and proteins, so meat and dairy products. Also more simple carbohydrates, which are sugars instead of complex carbohydrates, and more processed foods or food products. And in China, China's nutrition transition is sort of the textbook of this theory. We see income rising in China. We see urbanization rising quickly, especially in this period. We also see meat consumption rising, and again, you can see pork compared to chicken and beef here. And we see the massive explosion of processed foods. So Kentucky Fried Chicken is the largest foreign firm in China. There's about 5,000 stores. So it indeed looks like a nutrition transition. And the sister concept of the nutrition transition is the livestock revolution. This is way too much text, I know. But the key points here about the livestock revolution is the idea that the increasing production of livestock around the world is brought about by population growth, urbanization, and income growth. Sounds like the nutrition transition. Especially in developing countries, that's fueling a demand for food. And the other part of the livestock revolution, it often comes in development projects or development sort of ideologies as a way to provide income growth for smallholder farmers. If smallholder farmers can get in on these booms for meat, that necessarily is good for the smallholder. But I would say if we're trying to understand why meat booms, that we need new concepts. And indeed, I think this is something that's quite important to understand, given all that we know about the environmental and social implications of especially industrial meat production, and sort of the recognition that we need to change or slow these situations. So we need new analytical concepts and also new political concepts. And the critique that I'm trying to make is that these two approaches that we have, they are descriptive. Indeed, we can show income urbanization and diets changing in very predictable ways. It's not a question of that happens or it doesn't happen. We can show it empirically. The issue is that it describes, but it doesn't analyze. And it doesn't help us explain why we see those relationships. These approaches both take consumer demand as sort of a given. And I would say consumer demand is also something that's constructed. We should understand the processes and relations through which it gets constructed. And they say nothing about political economic forces. They say nothing about meat also being about profit and power. And this is sort of where I'm trying to intervene in the debate. So I've proposed this idea of an industrial meat regime, which I want to understand as a strategically managed set of policies, discourses, relations, and resources that are enacted. So it puts power in this instead of just thinking, oh, this is something that naturally happens. So they're enacted with the goal of increasing a particular form of meat production, commodity meat production, modern forms of meat consumption, and agribusiness profits. And this, I think, is key to analyzing where and why this happens. And it does go through articulating modernist notions of meat's progress with the relentless struggle. So in the talk, I want to just highlight some of the key features of what I'm trying to develop as the industrial meat regime, and then also talk a bit about some resistances and alternatives to it in China in particular. So just to say that the key to understanding the regime, as it were, is that this is a form of capitalist industrial livestock production, where indeed meat is also a source of profit and growth. It isn't just something that's meant to improve people's diets. It's also really a sector for extraction of profit. And in the work that I'm doing, I'm looking at how production and consumption in China in particular are increased through these four areas, which I'll discuss a bit in turn. So the first is CAFOs and soy imports. This is sort of technical and also about resources. Probably we all know what a CAFO is, just in case not. A CAFO is a confined or concentrated animal feeding operation. Animals are raised inside of buildings where feed is provided. And feed is usually, well, not usually, it's almost always some sort of, I'm not sure what word I want to use. Well, it's an industrial mix, usually made of soy and maize and a number of feed additives. So everything is provided to the animals, and the animal's goal, they have a single goal, is to convert that feed into meat. So in some ways, the animal is the ultimate value-added product, adding value to cheap commodities. This is the fastest growing form of livestock production in the world today. 80% of all livestock in the world are raised in some sort of confined animal feeding operation. So this isn't the minority, this is becoming a minority, and it's the form that comes along with development projects, with meat as development. In China, the CAFO is seen as inevitable. It's seen as a land-sparing technology. So if the goal is to increase meat consumption, which it has been, the CAFO is seen as the only way to do it. And that's so because China has 21% of the world's population, only 9% of the world's arable land. So there simply isn't enough land to grow pigs in a dispersed kind of way. This is the logic. They need to be put into small, again, the idea of land-sparing CAFOs. I just note here, on top of the already sort of limited land in China compared to the population, since 2000 and, I'm going to get the date wrong, I think it's 2012, land transfers have become a very important, very troubling process in rural China, where peasant households can transfer their land use rights to either industrial or industrial agricultural purposes. And since, at the end of 2013, 26% of peasant land have been transferred to non-peasant uses. And increasingly, it's going to large-scale agribusiness. But I put this here just to say that already limited land is further limited by the transfer of land out of rural and smallholder hands. But the CAFO is, of course, not land-sparing. The CAFO sort of invisibilizes the land and resources and labor that go into making this meat. And for China, it invisibilizes it in a way that it's pushing it geographically halfway across the world. So the way that CAFO is an industrial meat production in China is through importing soybeans, by 2013, China was the world's largest soy importer, even though soybeans originated in China, or indigenous to China. I realize it's a contestable word, but so it starts importing the world's soy. By 2016, it imports 62% of the global soy trade. So again, these are massive changes in a relatively short period of time. The outlook is that this will continue into the near and extended future. This idea of growth, that we'll just keep on producing more and more meat and importing more and more soy. And of course, this is something that sort of agribusiness will lick their lips at because, my God, this is a huge growth industry. These changes in China have the effect, for one thing, of starting to sort of shift the geography of soy. So if you look at Brazilian soybean exports, Brazil is either number one or two of the world's soybean. Soybeans going to China. The big global grain traders, A, B, C, D, Argentina, Midland, Bunge, Cargill, and Dreyfus, they still control or manage much of this trade, but we're starting to also see Chinese firms and Brazilian firms in bilateral trade agreements managing more and more of this trade. And so in terms of soy trade, in terms of the industrial meat regime in general, it's very much about agribusiness development. So just to give a little bit of history of agribusiness development in China, because it's really become the, one of the keys here to this regime, agribusiness emerges in China in the reform era. So in the 1980s and the 1990s, it emerges in a form called the company and the farm model. And this is basic contract farming. It started in, well, it wasn't a company at the time, a company that became the Wen's firm that was producing chicken. And so the idea is that you have the company providing the chicks, and you have the smallholder providing the labor and land to raise the chicks through your contract. Basic sort of contract situation. This is Wen Beiying, who is the person credited with starting the company in the farm model, and now his company is the largest pig and chicken producer in China. And you'll see this kind of rags to riches story is quite common to describe how development happened in China in the former era. The idea that there's some brilliant entrepreneur who has great idea and suddenly would have this modern food system. But the company and farm model gets formalized in policy in 2003. Formalized in the sense state supports the firm, and by supporting the firm, that support should trickle down to farmers because they're in an intimate contract relationship through this vertically integrated system. The key actors in this system, the company and farm model, are the companies that are called Dragonhead Enterprises. Dragonhead Enterprises are also called lead firms. They're named after the dragon dance, which is a dance where you have one dancer holding the head of a dragon, and then a number of dancers forming the body, and the head can kind of control where the body goes. So the Dragonhead Enterprise is meant to be the head, leading all these farmers along the path of modernization. Dragonhead Enterprises are meant to be processors, so that they contract with smallholders for raw inputs for their processing operations. They're meant to get 70% of their inputs from these kind of arrangements. They receive subsidies, other financial assistance, and also brand recognition for being a Dragonhead Enterprise. So this is actually a certification. You have to apply to become a Dragonhead. And when you apply to become a Dragonhead, you say that you will get 70% of your products from these relationships. That doesn't usually happen, but on paper. I put this here just to show kind of the way that the state frames and also thinks about Dragonheads is that they're not like ordinary commercial enterprises. They're opening new markets, innovating science and technology, driving farm households, and advancing regional economic development. So they're not just sort of a standalone agribusiness firm that's meant to just be making money. The idea is that they're the agents of rural development, really the agents of rural development. And also the agents of science and technology, so there's intimate links between the Dragonhead and research and universities as well. Dragonheads and this form of vertical integration, they're not the fringe at all in China's food system. These are official figures, 120,000 Dragonheads in 2013. They were integrating 40% of rural households on paper. The research that I did, I don't have a figure to dispute this, but I found it difficult to find Dragonheads who were actually engaging smallholder farmers in any way other than on the paper. But these are the figures I find most interesting. But this form of vertical integration, 70% of livestock production now taking place with the Dragonhead firm contracting or having some other relationship with the smallholder farmer in some way. Also to note that 10% of the land transfers that I mentioned are now going to Dragonheads. So just to say that this is not sort of something that's emerging or some sort of fringe part of the food system, it's becoming really the dominant piece of the food system. In 2012, there was the creation of this association of dragon heads, or lead enterprises, that's comprised of representatives from dragon head firms and from the state, and they're involved in different kinds of policy making, different kinds of market integration. And I include this here because it really shows the further kind of solidification of the state and agribusiness together, working together in order to bring about this modernization for food system. This is not to say, however, that dragon heads are just state firms. So dragon heads can be state-owned. There still are quite a number of some of the largest firms are state-owned firms, but they also can be privately owned. They can be a mixed state-private partnerships, and it can be joint ventures with foreign firms. So all of these are possible. So the dragon is not a state-owned enterprise, but it has interface with the state, private and state arrangements. And so I want to just say something about transnational agribusiness in China, following up on this idea that dragon heads can be foreign firms. When I first started doing research, I imagined I was going to look at how transnational firms were transforming China's food system. That was sort of the lens that we had at the time. Well, what's Cargill doing in China's food system? And that's not at all what I found. Transnationals are indeed in China, but sometimes in different ways than I was ready to see them. Transnationals are there in livestock genetics. They've been there since the 80s or 90s. These firms have been kind of changing China's swine herd. The top protein processors in the world all have small or medium or larger size operations in China. The big agricultural technology companies have operations in China. This is Big Dutchman, which is a Dutch company that's Herdsman, which is a Chinese sort of copycat company. So they take the same colors, it's all orange, and the same Big Dutchman, Big Herdsman. And if you looked at their displays, it's the exact same technologies. And so I asked the person at Big Dutchman, I said, well, what do you think about this company? Are they just ripping you off? And he said that for years they tried to stop these firms, and they'd take them to court, and they wouldn't get anywhere in court. And so they decided that the market was so big that it was worth it. So there's ways that transnationals operate in China that maybe they don't operate in other places, or maybe they do and we just don't talk about it, but it seems they've won the market so badly that they're willing to compromise on things that they're not really used to compromising on. So this, I think, is a fascinating little bit. And just to show, this is from some research I did on dragon head enterprises in different agricultural sectors. Shows the percentage of foreign firms in the top 10%. And you can see this is in pigs, there's very little foreign firm presence. Also in chicken, not so much, 20% let's say. Where we get a difference here is in soybeans. Soybean oil processing and soybean export. There's much more foreign presence, much more presence of the transnationals in soybeans. But even that is maybe not how we would expect it to be. So soybean crushing, China imports whole soybeans from Brazil, crushes them in China, so it's developed its own crushing industry, rather than importing soybean meal, which is going to be feed pigs, crushes the beans there. In 2004, China crushers had agreed to buy a shipment of beans from the United States at a time when the price was quite high. It was in May, I think. By the time that the deliveries were coming in August, the price had tanked. And so instead of losing all this, the grocer said, well, we're still going to default on the contract. The grain traders said, no, you're not. And so they took them to court, and grain traders won. And so all of these crushers in China, they went bankrupt in this moment. When they went bankrupt, the firms that swooped in and were able to save the day were foreign firms. And so in that moment, you start to see foreign firms take over the crushing industry so that there's 80% foreign-owned in 2009. And so this is sort of an anomaly. And I think I still don't know exactly how to understand this whole story, but just to say that it's anomaly. And just to say that in 2009, it's 80% foreign-owned. By 2013, it's only 60% foreign-owned. But the crusher capacity had gone up to 72% for Chinese firms. This means that the state and other interests in China are putting a lot of investment into crusher capacity, which indicates that they want to have to sort of regain more ownership over this sector that was sort of lost a bit to foreign control. So we see a lot of state support going both to state-owned enterprises and to private crushing firms. And I think this number of foreign control in this field will also continue to go down. And finally on this, just to say, even when we see foreign ownership in different sectors of China, that foreign ownership is often due to joint venture. So it looks like ADM and Wilmar are quite powerful players in soy crushing, and indeed they are, but they operate through a joint venture with COFCO, which is China's largest food and agricultural agribusiness state-owned enterprise. So all this is just to say that it's not so simply a story of transnational agribusiness taking over China. There's also this really quite a focus on developing domestic agribusiness firms, even if that means domestic agribusiness firms coming into relation with foreign firms. And finally, to say about Chinese agribusiness, further to this idea that the state and private interests are very much trying to develop domestic agribusiness. Starting in 1999, the state had a policy of going out, and this was support for Chinese firms, not just in agriculture, but otherwise, to invest and otherwise operate in other countries. So a way to sort of make Chinese firms transnational in their own right. One of the big questions in this is looking at Chinese firms and their overseas land deals. So this is some of the so-called land grab literature. I've looked at this a bit. I just list this here from a report about grain. These are deals for land that have been put on the books that may or may not have been completed. So I'm hesitant to say these are fully actualized deals. But where China and Chinese firms are looking to sort of acquire land or acquire different operations is in soybeans, in palm oil, and in dairy. So the way of taking its largest imports and trying to control more of the chain rather than just being the importer. And where analysts look for anticipation of further deals is in anticipated imports. But this is all the idea of China sort of going out, trying to think about how China is going. Part of the story of going out for land. So these are the biggest land deal firms from China going to Brazil, going to, not just Brazil, going to Africa, going to East Asia. And they're all state-owned enterprises and they're all genuine firms. But these firms don't just go out for land. There's also a number of mergers and acquisitions. So COFCO, again, the largest agribusiness acquired Noble and Madeira, big grain traders in the world. The WH Group, which used to be Shuanghui, bought Smithfield Foods. Smithfield was a US-based firm that was the largest pork processor in the world. Now it's owned by the WH Group, so China's home to the largest pork processor. And we have recently, this is still a negotiation, but Ken China has put in a bid to buy Syngenta. Syngenta, the world's second largest seed and agrochemical company in the world. And China coming on, sort of coming out of nowhere. For years we've had quite a lot of consolidation in agrochemicals and seed, but Ken China was not part of that story. There were about six firms, and then all of a sudden there comes Ken China. So it's another expression of the way that China's agribusiness is sort of going. As a result of this, we see a number of shifting values and ecologies within China, but also a bit broader than China. So to situate what I'm about to say, this is an estimate of the share of pork production or pig production by different farm types defined by farm size. So we have the backyard farmers, which the Rabobank defines as farms that grow 1 to 49 pigs per year. I would never go out backyard farm or someone that grows 50 pigs per year. I would say it's 1 to 10 pigs a year, but for the Rattle Bank, this is for them. And then a specialized farmer who grows 50 to 1,000 pigs per year. This is the fastest growing form of production. These are farmers who either on their own specialize in pigs and give up other crops, or it's a couple of farmers that come together and build a pig barn and start growing pigs together. And they usually will have some sort of relationship with the processor, with the dragon head. And then we have the commercial farms that are 1,000 pigs per year or more. So this is what the Rabobank estimates in 2015, that about a quarter of production was from backyard farmers, and you can see this here. For the Rabobank and for other analysts, they use this data to say that China's agri-food system is still largely run by smallholder farmers. But I would sort of take the opposite. I would say that about this much of the production is smallholder farmers, and the rest are in some way involved in the industrial type system, based on pigs that they're growing, the feeds that they're using, the relations they have, the markets they have. I would not call that the smallholder scale. So this, I think, is important because often in reports in the media, but also in development reports, we see all the time, China is still in the land of smallholder farmers, and this is some stumbling block to development. And I think that's absolutely the wrong way to think about this. The other thing I want to say about that is, if we take even the 27% of the Rattle Bank, or my 10%, this also starts to challenge the idea of the livestock revolution, that increasing meat consumption is really good for smallholder farmers. They're really benefiting. I think by this data alone, we can question that claim. Just quickly, I put these slides in here to show these commercial operations. These are the big corporate CAFOs. They look like a CAFO you would see in Iowa. They look like a CAFO you would see anywhere. Some of the firms in China are attempting to produce 100,000 pigs per year in the same site. These are like pig cities where you have hundreds of CAFOs together and thinking, well, let's just concentrate it all in one area. Again, this is concentrated. These are operations with state subsidies, and they're selling to super and hypermarkets. Then the range of the specialized household farm. These might be contract farmers, and they might hire some wage labor on their farms. They're using some form of concentrated production. These aren't pigs out running around, which means they're using some sort of concentrated feed, which is part of why we count them not among the smallholders. They're purchasing a lot of feed. They have some state subsidies, not as much as their commercial, very large scale, and they'll sell to a combination of super hypermarkets and wet markets. And then finally, you have the backyard farm. These are smallholder farmers. They have no wage laborers on their farms, but probably they're able to exist because they're living on wage labor remittances from some members of the family who are working in factories, restaurants, other places, and they're not really producing for sale, producing for self-consumption, and sometimes if there's extra, you might sell to a neighbor to a market. There's a lot to say about the way that backyard farmers are sort of kept out of the meat boom. They can't produce the kind of pigs that the processors want. So we can talk about that if that's of interest, but here I'll just let it angle. So, in this context of this trafficking of pork production, industrialization, the scaling up, a number of shifts have taken place. The first is really a shift in value, and I mean both economic value and value also in terms of something like agroecological value. In a backyard farmer situation, which was most of China's history, 7,000 years, almost everyone in rural China produced a pig. The value of the pig was the pig itself, what the pig did in the agroecosystem. The pig ate kitchen scraps and agricultural scraps, and it pooped, which underwrote the grain-based diet in this country for thousands and thousands of years. So the value here is the pig. Today, the value is really the commodity pork. It's where the economic value comes from, but it's also the reason for growing pigs would be to sell commodity pork. This is really quite a profound shift in terms of those economic, again, and kind of social values. should also mention that packaged and processed meat products are the highest growth sector of meat as well. That's another change, is that it's meat under plastic, which is a new thing for China. What goes right along with this is there's also a shift in manure, now called the pig fertilizer factory on four legs, again because the pig pooped, and that's where fertilizer came from for grain crops. The shift now is that manure is the largest source of water pollution in China. A massive shift from manure being something valuable, useful, fertilizer, to being something that's a waste and you have to figure out something to do. Another organization, profound shift. There's a shift in the actual pigs themselves. So China, as home of pig domestication 7,000 years ago, it has, well, in 1961, I think, a survey showed that China had 100 indigenous pig breeds with thousands of local varieties. So kind of each place would have its own pig variety that had been raised there for a very long time, was very used to the local conditions. This is an old indigenous pig. She's pregnant and probably has about 16 babies in her belly. Those pigs have all but been replaced by the modern industrial hog. DLY stands for Durlock, Landrace, and Yorkshire. And these are the three breeds that populate CAFOs and industrial livestock in livestock operations all around the world. Someone in the Ministry of Agriculture told me that about 95% of China's pork is coming from DLY pigs, either in pure form from commercial operations or as they've been hybridized with indigenous pigs. So this is a shift that has important implications for biodiversity. There's efforts to conserve indigenous pig genetics, but it's difficult with pigs. You have to raise out live animals. You can't use frozen semen. So there are conservation farms. People that I talked to running those farms would say they don't have the resources enough to make sure that they're having robust lines being reproduced. Combining the form of feeding with the new form of pigs, there's actually a different kind of meat that's produced. So Chinese indigenous pigs who eat scraps, they eat mostly carbohydrates, they produce a kind of meat that has a lot of fat, layered fat. And this is the basis of Chinese culinary culture. It's sort of what people who are old enough to remember define as meat. Today, the modern hog produces a lean meat. And this isn't quite a fair comparison because these are different cuts of meat. The point is that the modern pig, it produces thinner muscular fat instead of this fat. So even people who lived before the industrial meat regime, let's say, they will say this meat tastes terrible. You can get meat every day, but you have to eat this meat that has no flavor for them. It's awful. It's interesting that with surveys of younger folks, they started to prefer meat because they didn't grow up with this reference to fatty meat. And so for them, the fatty meat is disgusting. It's terrible. They want to eat this lean meat, which I think is also a very clear statement of the way that consumer demand is also a construct, right? It's also what you demand is based on what you expect. So these different pigs, these different agroecological practices produce different kinds of meat, which then also result in the production of different kinds of consumer demand. This is from Campbell and Campbell, their book, The China Study. I just put this here to show that there's also impacts for public health. I'm not trying to say that all of these modern diseases of affluence come from meat, but they're certainly part of it. And so we see a shift in China's public health as diets have changed. And finally, the good old agrarian question is alive and well in China, where we see shifting labor from peasants to people becoming workers, not only, of course, in meat processing plants, but this shift is underway. So depeasantization is happening. It's a complicated relationship in China, given internal the hukou system and the internal passport system, but just to say that this shift is also happening. So we can think about these shifts as metabolic rifts. This is Marx's concept for describing the rupture of agricultural practices, but also ruptures in kind of human nature relations that happen with the imposition of a capitalist mode of production. And a couple of ways to think about these metabolic rifts One is that it's a metabolic rift on a global scale. So with all of the soy coming from Brazil and the United States, mostly to feed China's pigs, we have the kind of environmental implications of monoculture, highly industrial soy production that happens in Brazil and the United States. And the corollary, we have all this poop from the pigs that are eating that soy in China. So in that way, it's metabolic rift on a global scale. And again, just to show, this picture I took outside of an industrial pork operation in Sichuan province, it's untreated manure dumped into the water, which creates a eutrophic condition. And it's the number one source of water pollution in the country, and it's also related to just the massive degradation of China's water supply. And I'm thinking about the degradation of water is also, in a way, the degradation of land, right? If you're a farmer and you don't have water, what good is your land if you're trying to grow something that needs water, which for most people is kind of growing needs water. There's also a rural-urban metabolic rift. This is more how Marx was, well not more, but this is directly how Marx was thinking about the metabolic rift. So thinking about the meat boom is predominantly in China an urban middle and upper class phenomenon. At the moment, at least. Meat consumption in urban China is at least twice as much as consumption in rural China. But I think that number is well, not fake. I know that number is vastly underestimated. It's probably something more like four times as much in urban areas. And still, most of these implications are left in the rural areas for rural people who are already marginalized to deal with. So it's a way of thinking about the class component of this. That the push to increase meat production, meat consumption for middle and upper class people is really raw on the backs of poor and poverty marginalized people in rural China. So I think we can think of that as a rural-urban metabolic rift. Also thinking about an epistemic rift, meaning what happens to geographically specific knowledges about agricultural production, but also about consumption, when we see people moving in this way, and we see people leaving the land, people leaving agriculture, or people becoming wage workers or contract farmers in these relationships. And there's questions of whose knowledge gets to count. And certainly in China today, the knowledge that counts is the knowledge of the so-called modern agriculture. So I just have one thing to say here about discourses of modernity and peasant that are also an important part of this regime. Mostly I'm talking about these political-economic mechanisms, but there's also these discursive moves and sort of these more cultural notions that I think also serve to propel something like an industrial meat regime. This is a picture from the first international soybean association expo or something that I went to in Heilongjiang. And it was an expo, like most expos, but it had a night of dance and song performance. It was 3 hours of this. Images of industrial mechanized agriculture with different singing and dancing, folks who dressed like corn. It's really quite spectacular. But it's also, to me, this just signifies this idea that there's this equation of progress with modern agriculture. And modern agriculture means precisely this. It's also the encounter of Chinese culture with modern agriculture, with chemicals and mechanization and companies. And importantly, what it also is a rejection of peasant. It's an absolute rejection of peasant production, of small-scale production, of anything that doesn't look like a company. It doesn't look, that's what's defined as modern. So there's a very successful equation of peasant with backwards, with the opposite of modern. And I would say even the definition of the peasant as backwards is part of what defines the modern. The two can't be broken apart. So, coming to the end now, we have this meat regime, which always sounds like Darth Vader. There's also resistance and response and alternatives, which just, this is an area that I'm just starting to look at, so I just have a few things to say about it. The first thing is that wherever we're seeing resistance or alternatives, the guiding force or the most powerful force are people's concerns about food safety. and also about pollution. I think probably all of us have seen media reports about contamination in China's food system, the melamine in the milk, hormones, antibiotics, chemical residues. So this food safety concern, more than just a concern with environmental implications of food production, really food safety drives most of the alternatives. So in China today, there's green food, which is a label, green food label. There's organic farming, organic food, which also have labels. And of course, they also have the politics. And there's also ideas around local food production. These things are all emerging. And again, largely it's middle and upper class consumers who are concerned about not eating toxins. There are farmers markets. This is the Beijing Farmers Market, which was started by a group of researchers in Tianlan, you probably know from IIT, Chong Tianlan, is one of the people who is very much involved in starting this. In Beijing and also in Shanghai, there's big and becoming quite successful farmers markets, and this idea is starting to spread to other places. Again, it's very expensive food, and this farmers market is set up in kind of the most expensive part of Beijing in the shopping district. The critique doesn't mean to be the end of it, but just to say that this is something that's serving a particular group of people. It's not something that's, you know, peasants aren't eating this food for sure. There's also community-supported agriculture farming in China. In 2008 was the first real CSA farm, and now there's somewhere around 500 CSA farms in the country. This is also something that's increasing, and both foreign scholars and some Chinese scholars are looking at it. And again, everyone is saying that when they interview people for why are you in a CSA, it's about food safety. It's that they want to have some sort of connection to the farm, some sort of trust in the farmer to know that they're not putting melamine in the milk. There's new markets for indigenous boutique pigs. Again, this is very much for the elite. This picture I took at a farm in Sichuan, a farmer that used to be a financial advisor, and he had a daughter, and when he had the daughter, he got really concerned about all the environmental pollution. So he quit his job. He was already a millionaire. He was pretty wealthy. He quit his job, became Taoist, and started a biodynamic farm where he breeds indigenous pigs. And now he sells this very expensive pork to people in Chengdu, and has a restaurant as well. But he is keeping alive a number of indigenous pig breeds through his operation. It's just that his market is kind of like a Gucci of pork. Gucci is a big question. There's also less meat initiatives. In 2016, the dietary guidelines in China came out that said people should be eating 50% less meat. This was amazing. People got very excited about it. I think it's also great, the dietary guidelines, that's all. And when you look at the policies that come out before that and at the same time they continue to come out, there's nothing in them that indicates that there's any plans for less meat pork, not just pork, meat production. There's still more and more subsidies for the industry. So yes, this is a good thing, but the extent to which it actually means anything, I think something to remain a bit critical about. The other thing to say is that we do see meat consumption starting to decrease a bit among certain urban classes. And the idea is that now, because rural meat consumption has been so low, the idea is to create this as a new consumer class, to try to reach this as an untapped resource. And that's in meat, but that's also in the China economy in general, a real push to increase domestic consumption instead of, well, in electronics, just exporting, but also in terms of meat to try to create new consumers. But this is from colleagues at the Beijing Farmers Market. They've written all of these initiatives are far from being influential, let alone mainstream. So it's good that they exist. I would also say if you track these things in the popular press, we've seen a lot of press action on CSA farms in China. And yet, it's a small piece. So it's good to have some sort of hope, but they shouldn't be overblown. We shouldn't all rest and think, everything is fine now, there's CSA farms. Well, there's a few. And they would say, instead, we have this idea of modernization and capitalization as the only way to maintain country's food security, safeguard food safety, and remain competitive in foreign products. So this is another way of them just saying, these initiatives are great, but they're still a really quite small. So, coming now to a conclusion, I would say our current situation is that this meat-free gene is still quite dominant. It's characterized by a state and corporate-led form of modernization, modernization being defined as particularly industrial agriculture. Based on industrialization, capitalization, it's really about domestic agribusiness development that can be done in concert with transnationals. But the way that Chinese domestic firms are developing is something I think we need to watch for trying to understand global agricultural development in the coming decades. And it's also based on externalizing these land and environmental problems. One way to look at soybean imports is to look at the ways in which it's helping China get around the problems of large-scale monocrop soybean agriculture by just leaving those problems in Brazil and the United States. At the same time, the regime is bringing about agrarian, food, and environmental crises, both in China and, I would say, related to the places where its inputs are grown. The creation of waste. Poop on its own is not waste. It's created as a waste, but it's somehow above and beyond a level. I don't want to sound like an oversimplified balance in agroecology, but I will anyway. It's bringing about pollution and these ruptured nutrient cycles, and also bringing about these emerging civil society responses. So I have a lot that's critical to say about them, but also their emergence, I think, is, we can say a positive sign, it's also an inevitable sign, right? When things go too far, people react. So I need to check that. The point of all this that I'm trying to make is that meat consumption doesn't rise spontaneously. Meat's also about power and profit. And these nutrition transitions and livestock revolutions, we can talk about them descriptively, but they're also brought about and they're managed.